I always like to ask, you know, go back 20 years. Is there any advice you'd give yourself? I think I already know the answer because you've said it twice about spending probably too much time in before you exited your landscape business. But is there anything that you would have done 20 years ago different than you've done now to get you to this point?
You know, if I would have known, oh man, but you know, that journey is so critical because there's so many components. Like I really learned how to, you know, I learned about work ethic from my friend's businesses, working for my friend. I learned about operations and marketing from working in the hotel industry. You know, so there were all these and customer service. So there are all these journey points that I learned different things, and it was accumulation. And for some people, the timing is, you know when the timing's right. Looking back, would I have probably been successful starting my own business earlier? I would probably say yes. However, the capital that I got from to start my business to buy the landscape company came from stock options and things like that I received when I was working in corporate America. So I had money to put down and buy a business as opposed to starting a business from scratch. You know, could I have started the landscape business from scratch? Man, it would have been tough. Like I would have had a lot more fear. You know,
well, and you would have had the training from the two owners that you had two years of apprenticeship with.
That's exactly right. So a lot of things would have been different. And, you know, the other thing I want to share with, you know, entrepreneurs that are out there, you know this firsthand, right? Fear is a good thing when you own a company and you're operating. And the fear doesn't stop. It doesn't matter if your company, you know, goes from $500,000 in sales to $1 million or from $1 million to two or for two to three. You always get uncomfortable, Joe. Isn't that right?
Oh yeah. Because you're always wondering, you know, what are you going to do if that switch, if that faucet turns off?
You know? right.
And nobody wants to hire somebody and lay them off. You know,
that's right. Nobody, that's exactly right.
Yeah, and you are right. And you know, even when COVID hit, you know, we let a lot of our people work from home, and I had a bunch of people surprised how much I was showing up. And they're like, why are you going in? You know, there's a pandemic. And I'm like, cause I, unlike other people, I can't allow my company to fail. Yeah. This is my baby, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I, everybody's telling me, don't worry about it. It'll all be okay. But I'm worried, you know?
Yeah.
And, I think you've got to be an entrepreneur to understand, like you said, that fear, you know, sometimes in that time, I mean, when I look back for me at my leadership skills, I actually apologized to a lot of my key people. And you know, Tanner, I know, listens to my podcast, and Tanner was, he's my GM, was one of them, because I always like aspire to be the best leader I can be. And
sure.
I have like a regrettable Zoom call that I did where I was like, I want everybody back here. And I was pissed, you know? And, you know, I mean, these are regrettable moments, but it's because, you know, I reacted to being fearful. I reacted to, you know, what's going to happen when everybody's at home getting unemployment. I can't get that unemployment.
Right. It's a new situation for you.
Pay for my trucks. And unemployment doesn't pay for the building, you know?
Right. That's right. It's a high risk situation. So,
yeah.
You know, but that's just a healthy piece of advice for everybody. I think entrepreneurs, while they may seem secure and successful, always have a little bit of fear in the background, and they're cautious, and there's a conservative side to them. So, you know.
Yeah, I always say, I don't know that for me it's fear. I always say it's anxiety. You know, sometimes people will, right? Yeah, like I'll hear people talk about suffering from depression or whatever, and I'm always like, yeah. I suffer from anxiety. I'm the guy that when I have the time to kick back, I'm like, all of a sudden I'm like suffering from boredom. And then I'm like,
yeah, you're a go guy. You're what I call a go guy. You can't sit still.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, exactly. I was, we all have our own strengths as owners, right? One of the strengths I had was I was able to compartmentalize. So as I was driving home from work, you know, when I left the office and locked up at 5:30 and I was driving home, I was kind of 30 minutes. I was kind of decompressing. And then I got home and like work very rarely came into the, you know, the equation once I got home.
Yeah. I see total opposites. So we, it's one of the things I struggle most with, because, you know, so my daughter is my COO of Automated Outdoor. She's only 20. She's like literally one of the brightest young women, like, I think, out there. I mean, seriously, I tell her all the time, like, Julia, you could literally be president one day. Like, seriously, I have no idea how intelligent you are.
Yeah.
And she actually used to do the podcast with me, but she's back in college now. So I'm kind of letting her take a break from this. But the, but then my two stepsons install robots for me. So imagine there's really no shutting off. And then my other stepson does the resets on the weekend. And I mean, and it's important for everybody to know, I have a lot more employees than this, you know, but everybody that is in my house loves what we're doing. As a matter of fact, my fiance is pissed off because she doesn't work for me.
Yeah.
She's always like, what? Everybody else gets to work with you. Why don't I? And I'm like, that's what I, it's like, as a father, I can be a mentor and a, like, this is what you're going to do it for me.
Yeah.
I really don't want to be telling my fiance, I don't really like the way you put that report. I could see.
That's a no win. That's a no win. Right.
Yeah. You know, so that's one that I've kept separate, I don't ever do the disconnect, unfortunately. And sometimes especially my daughter's sake, sometimes I wish I would, cause I'm probably not teaching her every now and then. You got to turn the switch off, you know?
Yeah.
So,
you know, Joe, you asked about, you know, words of advice. What I would say is, you know, if you work hard and you're consistent and you enjoy the people that you work with, you provide good service to customers, you understand what you're going to deliver to, you know, as a product or a service. If you understand and like the people you work with and provide them with good internal customer service, you're going to build a work ethic and a culture that people are going to really like, and that's going to help you be successful, you know? And
yeah.
95% of the people, 90% of the other people out there are not going to do those things. So there's real simple things that you could do to really set yourself up to be successful. Because, you know, like, people like you and me know that we want people like that working for us. And we want people like that coming in and taking over our roles in the business and working with us at an executive level to be successful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, one of the next questions I was going to ask is, how do you differentiate yourself from your competitors? But I kind of feel like your piece of advice also talks about how you're differentiating, because you're just putting together a culture that 90% of people are not, like you just said in your own words.
It is about the service culture. We listen to customers. We're more field focused than anybody else. So we're listening to ideas and opportunities to develop our product better for our customers in the field. And we just came out with a feature. So we're working with a company in a large landscape company called Mainscape. And one of the guys at the meeting, his name is Zane, and he runs their agronomy division. And he said, hey, Mike, can we automate this address feature so that when our techs are at a property in a large HOA, they don't have to write down the address or type it into Capture every time they use it? I said, so I talked to my chief information officer. She said, yeah, let's develop it for him. So now all they do when they drop a pin of a 1-inch valve, and they drop a picture of a 1-inch valve and touch it on a house, it automatically pulls in that address. So we know where, what specific house within that HOA, that $350 valve was installed. And Mainscape has that information, so they can share that specific information with their client groups. And there's no billing errors, right? You don't have I didn't recognize, I got the address wrong. And then somebody at the HOA gets the wrong address and they get frustrated. And then, you know, they're like, oh, they're not competent enough to service our account. We've automated that issue to just make it simpler for everybody.
Well, and it's something I want to add. You know, a lot of times I think when a HOA or a business, whoever it is, lets a landscaping or any professional go, it could be an electrician, plumber, whatever, there's a lot of things that have led up to it. They're literally waiting for that reason to give them the excuse to fire you. They're almost like waiting for that moment, you know? So you've probably made a mistake 6 or 8 times that they didn't feel like that was enough. That was a big enough reason for them to comfortably say, hey, we've got to move forward. But then there's that one moment where you send them a bill for a $350 valve and it's not at that house. And then they can question your integrity, question your bookkeeping, and now they're just like, hey, how much more did this happen? I'm not gonna we just can't.
I can't deal with this, right? I'm supposed to be taking care of. I'm a property manager. I'm taking care of my HOA clients, and I'm dealing with billing discrepancies from the landscaper, right? I can't do this. That's not my job.
Yep.
I'm too busy for this, right? So make it easy, and we automate that.
Yeah, well, like I always tell my people, you know, don't keep your foot in the door for the next contractor to walk in. You know, get to the job, do the job, finish the job, close the job. If you do it all right, that door closes behind you, and there's not an opportunity for the next contractor to walk in.
That's right. That's great. Your philosophies are dead on.